Bing Crosby. Mahalia Jackson. Johnny Lee. Johnny Mathis. Paul McCartney and Wings. Donny Osmond. John Schneider. Plus Christmas greetings from Ringo Starr. The Pointer Sisters. Lionel Richie. Eddie Rabbit. And Santa Claus. Now, here's your host, Casey Kasem.
Thank you and hello again, everybody. Welcome to our special America's Top 10 Christmas Countdown. During the next 60 minutes, we'll be counting down the 10 most popular and best-selling Christmas songs of our time. Of course, there was a time when only Christians were interested in celebrating Christmas. After all, it's the birthday of the man for whom Christianity and Christmas were named. But today, Christmas belongs to everyone, to people of all faiths, because when it comes to peace on earth and goodwill toward men, we're all believers. And every year at this time, music is one of the ways that we celebrate the spirit of Christmas. And around the world, families and friends gather to sing and share a special feeling. It's a celebration of joy. And here at America's Top 10, we feel that way too. As Paul McCartney and Wings say, we're having a wonderful Christmas time.
The mood is right. The spirit's up. We're here tonight. And that's enough. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. The party's on. The feeling's here. That only comes this time of year. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. The choir of children sing their song.
Up our spirits exactly. That's Paul McCartney and Wings with Wonderful Christmas Time. You know, here at America's Top 10, we've ranked the 10 top Christmas songs of the rock era based on the record charts of Billboard magazine and on the research of music historian Joseph Morels. And here we go with our special countdown. Interestingly enough, the song at number 10 was written long, long before rock and roll ever happened. It was actually composed Christmas Eve in the year 1818 in the tiny village of Arnsdorf, high in the Austrian Alps. The words were written by a priest named Joseph Moore. And those words were set to music by the village organist Franz Gruber. At first, it was called Song from Heaven. But as the popularity of that tune spread, it became better known by its opening words. In German, those words were Stille Nacht, Heilige Nacht. Silent night, holy night. Here's the great gospel singer, Mahalia Jackson.
And by the way, this is a rare performance of this Christmas classic.
The late Mahalia Jackson, singing one of the great songs of Christmas, Silent Night. Coming in at number 10 in our special America's Top 10 Christmas Countdown. Next, I have a novelty song by the youngest solo singer to ever hit the top 40. He was only 6 years old when he discovered he was getting nothing for Christmas.
To everybody, have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And don't only be friendly at Christmas, be friendly all through the year. And stop. Smell the roses.
In our survey of the 10 biggest Christmas hits of the rock era, we're up to number 9 now. And it's a song that set an all-time chart record for the youngest solo singer to ever hit the top 40. The song hit in the first Christmas season of the rock era back in 1955 when the boy who sang it was only 6 years old. His name is Barry Gordon, and he's since gone on to succeed as an actor. He starred in the movie A Thousand Clowns and was a regular on the TV series The New Dick Van Dyke Show, among others. And you've probably seen his face in a lot of commercials. We spoke to Barry Gordon recently, and he told us that his career really began at age 3 with an appearance on the Ted Mack Amateur Hour. That led to the Milton Berle Show, and that led to Nothing for Christmas.
I wound up on the Berle Show, the Milton Berle Show, and Art Mooney was also a guest on the show. And I was doing my thing and he was doing his. We'd never met. And right after the show was shot, it was live, you know, and he came over to my parents and said, we'd like Barry to do a Christmas song. He said, I have a Christmas song and we've been thinking of using an adult, but it would be more effective to use a kid. So that was it. We went and did Nothing for Christmas.
I'm getting nothing for Christmas.
I was always singing very adult songs. And this was really the first kiddie song I'd ever done. But it just took off. It was amazing.
That's Barry Gordon, who became the youngest solo singer ever to hit the top 40 with his Nothing for Christmas hit back in 1955. And that song winds up at number 9 in our special countdown. You know, while we were compiling this countdown of the 10 biggest Christmas hits of the rock era, we couldn't help but notice that every song in the survey had been written at least 20 years ago, and many of them much older than that. But people are still writing and recording new Christmas songs every year. And we did a little checking around to see if we could find a new Christmas song that was being recorded. And we found one by none other than the fast-driving co-star of the TV series The Dukes of Hazzard, John Schneider. We spoke to the song's writers, a team who call themselves Jeff and Jeff, and we asked them about the difficulties of writing a new Christmas song.
One of the difficult things was to try to find some element in this song that would make it different from all of the standards that had already been written, because Christmas is a subject that's been covered so well by so many writers for so many centuries that it was extremely difficult to try to find some kind of new angle or something distinctive that would work for our song.
Well, what they finally came up with is a Christmas song that deals with the common problem of divorce. Their song is about a little girl by the name of Katie and the hurt she feels at Christmas time because her parents are separated. So the little girl sends her father a Christmas card asking him to come home for the holidays, but she signs it from the mother. Then she sends her mother the same card and signs it with the father's name. Well, as the song unfolds, they finally get back together for Christmas. Listen now as John Schneider interprets this touching Christmas song.
Yeah, feels good.
It reads, there's no place like home for Christmas. There's no better feeling I know. The presents around the tree in your own family. And Christmas won't be Christmas if I'm not coming home. All it took was one kiss in the doorway. They could feel that old feeling again. The look in their eyes, so loving and tender, was just like it was back then. Katie watched them together, and she brushed a teardrop away and smiled as she thought of those two Christmas cards she mailed just yesterday. She cried, there's no place like home for Christmas. There's no better feeling I know. With presents round the tree and your whole family. Now Christmas can be Christmas, 'cause everybody's home. Now this Christmas can be Christmas, 'cause everybody's home.
Actor and singer John Schneider with Katie's Christmas Card. One of the many songs that come out at Christmas written and sung by people who hope they'll be lucky enough to hit with a new Christmas classic. Well, now we're up to a song at number 8. A Christmas song that's hit the pop chart twice in the rock era. First time was in 1961 when soul singer Charles Brown recorded his version, and that single quickly became a million seller. Then, in 1978, one of America's most popular country rock bands, the Eagles, recorded their version of this song, and it became a hit. With an even more countrified version, here's Johnny Lee with Please Come Home for Christmas.
Bells will be ringing, such glad, glad news. Oh, what a Christmas to have a blues. My baby's gone, and I have no friends to wish me greetings. Once again, choirs will be singing. Silent night and Christmas carols by candlelight. Please come home for Christmas. Come home for Christmas. If not once again.
Number 8 in our special Christmas countdown, Please Come Home for Christmas by country star Johnny Lee. Coming up next, a Christmas song about old Saint Nick that's been recorded by everyone from Bing Crosby to Bruce Springsteen.
Oh, great. Really bugged me. I mean, it really wiped me out. You have to know that I was waiting on Santa Claus every year. I mean, every Christmas I couldn't wait. And it was my job every Christmas Eve turn the fireplace. We had gas logs. And I was supposed to turn the fire out every night because otherwise Santa couldn't come down the chimney. Well, I forgot.
Forgot.
And my father, wanting to play a joke on me, came in the next morning and said, "You forgot to turn the fireplace out." And it had such an emotional effect on me, I almost died. I said, "Oh my God." He said, I said, was Santa hurt? He said, "Well, you burned him a little bit on his coat and his jacket, but Mom and I got him together, but he's okay, he loves you. But he wanted to tell you next year, be careful, turn the log."
He didn't leave you there.
Today we're counting down to the number one Christmas hit of all time, and we're at number 7 in our America's Top 10 Special Christmas Countdown. It's a song that was written back in 1942. And since then, it's become a Christmas classic and has been responsible for the good behavior of millions of boys and girls in the weeks leading up to Christmas. Over the years, this song's been recorded hundreds of times by all sorts of acts. There are versions by Bing Crosby, the Andrews Sisters, by Burl Ives, the Crystals, the Beach Boys, the Jackson 5, even by Bruce Springsteen. Here now is Pat Boone with his version of Santa Claus Is Coming to Town.
You better watch out, better not cry, better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list, checking it twice, gonna find out who's naughty and nice. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping, he knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good. For goodness sake, you better watch out, you better not cry, better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming down. He sees you when you're sleeping, he knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good, so be good, so be good. You better not cry, better not pout, I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town.
Santa Claus is coming to town by Pat Boone, the 7th biggest Christmas song in our special America's Top 10 Countdown. Got a trivia question for you. What fictional character has had the most songs written about him? Of course, it's Santa Claus. But you know, maybe Santa Claus isn't a fictional character after all. Because Santa Claus is as real as we want him to be. He can be any color, he can be any nationality. Recently, we visited a fellow by the name of Robert George, who's been Santa Claus for 7 United States presidents, as well as thousands of children all over the world. And he told us how he came to wear that famous red suit.
I had a dream that I was supposed to become the real Santa and put the true Christmas spirit in the hearts of everyone. In this dream, I visualized seeing myself going around to homes, knocking on doors, calling on the children and the grown-ups. And also I seen myself standing in front of the White House because I dreamt that I was going to meet the president.
Well, Mr. Robert George began telling people about his dream. He even told a U.S. senator about it.
When I called up Carl T. Curtis, he was the senator of Nebraska for 40 years at the Capitol there and just retired last year, and I asked him, told him about my dream and all. He said, yes, I read and heard about it. And I said, well, how about the, what would be the chance of me going in and meet the president and greet him for Christmas? And all. He said, well, we'll see what we can do. Well, a few days later, I got a letter and also a phone call followed up by the letter that I was invited to the Christmas lighting of the tree.
And this is what happened when Robert George arrived at the White House.
Eisenhower got out of the car and came around and shook hands and put his arm around me and said, you're the best dressed blue-eyed Santa I've ever seen. He says, I'm appointing you the official Santa right here and now. Oh, Mr. President, thank you. God bless you.
And that's how it all began. But when Robert George isn't busy being the presidential Santa Claus, he lives in Orange County, California, with Mrs. Claus, of course, and his activities as Santa Claus never end. On the day of our interview, he took us on a trip to meet some special children at the Hope Special Education Center, one of the many places he visits to spread the joy of Christmas.
I always like to be on call where some child or grown-up even that might not be able to be here for Christmas, and I'd like to go give him that Christmas, whatever day of the year or the month it is, I'd like to be able to go do that. I get the biggest kick out of going to these places because when I can see the eyes tell me that they're real happy and that I came to see them, and I feel I've done the job of putting the real true Christmas spirit in their hearts and making them happy, because as long as I can make people happy and see them smiling, I feel great. I feel I'm doing the job that I'm supposed to be doing.
Yep, there really is a Santa Claus. And there always will be. Well, now on our America's Top 10 Christmas Countdown, we're up to a song that was written back in 1934, has sold more than 40 million records since, written by Dick Smith and Felix Bernard. And it's a Christmas song that doesn't actually make any direct reference to Christmas. It's a love song, actually, and it paints a beautiful picture of snow and sleigh bells and snowmen, a real winter wonderland. Here's Johnny Mathis with his version of that Christmas classic.
Sleigh bells ring, are you listening? In the land, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. Walking in a winter wonderland. Gone away is the bluebird. Here to stay is a new bird. He sings a love song as we go along, walking in the winter wonderland. In the meadow we can build a snowman, then pretend that he is Parson Brown. He'll say, are you married? We'll say, no man, but you can do the job when you're in town. Later on we'll conspire as we dream by the fire, to face unafraid the plans that we made, walking in the winter wonderland.
Survey song number 6 in our special Christmas countdown, The Great Johnny Mathis and Winter Wonderland. Well, coming up next at number 5 is a Christmas song that also happens to be the most successful novelty song of the rock era.
I mean, I know it sounds corny and everything, but there's nothing like having a Christmas tree all fixed up nice and big when I turn all the lights off in it. In the room and sit there and just be into that and nothing else. It is. I get goosebumps talking about it. It's real special to me. I think everyone should have a time like that when nothing else in the world matters.
You know, so far on America's Top 10 Christmas Show, I've been telling you a lot about Christmas music. But there's a lot of surprising Christmas trivia that I didn't know, and you may be surprised to find out too. True or false? Christmas has always been called Christmas. Well, if you said false to that, you're right. The first usage of the word Christmas didn't come until the 11th century. It's an old English term which refers to the Mass held Christmas Eve, known as Christ's Mass. True or false? Christmas is December 25th because that's the day Christ was born. Well, again, if you said false, you'd be right. Scholars aren't sure of Christ's exact birth date, and December 25th wasn't celebrated as that day until the year 440 AD. That day coincided with the old calendar and the first day of winter. true or false, Christmas carols have always been a type of song. Once again, if you said false, you'd be right. The first carolers were dancers, and caroling was introduced in the 13th century in Italy by St. Francis of Assisi in an effort to make Christianity more joyful. Originally, a Christmas carol was a type of ring dance that would be done while people were singing. And finally, did you know that the piggy bank first originated with Christmas in 19th century England? That was when employers would give their workers gifts of money inside clay piggy banks. Pigs were believed to be a symbol of good luck. Little Christmas trivia I thought you might enjoy. Well, now in America's Top 10, we're up to the fifth biggest Christmas song in our countdown. And it's also the biggest novelty song of the rock era. Here's the story. Way back in 1958, after hitting number one with a song called Witch Doctor, record producer David Seville, whose real name was Ross Bagdasarian, decided to try doing a Christmas song featuring a chorus of electronically created animal voices. He recorded the song at various speeds and finally decided the version he liked best sounded a lot like Chipmunks. And that's how the Chipmunks were born. That first record, the Chipmunk song, went on to sell 3.5 million copies in its first 5 weeks. And charted, became a hit in 58, 59, 60, 61, and 1962. Here are Simon, Theodore, and of course, Alvin, the Chipmunks.
Chipmunks, ready to sing your song?
I'll say we are. Yeah, let's sing it now.
Okay, Simon?
Okay.
Okay, Theodore?
Okay.
Okay, Alvin? Alvin? Alvin!
Okay! Christmas, Christmas time is near. Time for toys and time for cheer.
Very good, Theodore. Alvin, you were a little flat. Watch it, Alvin. Alvin. Enough. Let's not overdo it.
What do you mean overdo it? We want to sing
it. Now, wait a minute, boys.
Yes, Daddy, why can't we sing it?
Alvin, cut that. Wait a minute. Theodore, just a minute. Simon, will you cut that out?
At number five in our special countdown, Simon, Theodore, and Alvin with the Chipmunk song. Coming up, the top four Christmas songs, including a song from the biggest-selling Christmas album of all time.
She didn't have a Christmas tree full of gifts. I mean,
yeah,
it doesn't matter whether they're weak. Used gifts, rewrapped, or whatever.
Oh, one thing I remember is when one Christmas, Mother took my doll and asked me if I would let her take it and send it to a needy family. And
oh, yeah.
I thought that was just so, oh, how could you do it? How could you take my doll and give it? And then after I went to visit that area, it was in the South. She sent it to Arkansas, to where my grandmother lived. And I went there and saw how those people were living in these little shotgun houses with no carpet, no nothing, no running water in the house. And I understood why she did things like that.
You're watching America's Top 10 Christmas Countdown, and we're up to number four. Number four is the first hit to ever combine Christmas with rock and roll. It was a big hit for Bobby Helms in the years 1957, 58, 60, 61, and 62. And it was also a big hit for the duo of Bobby Rydell and Chubby Checker in 1961 and 62. With one of the many versions of this rock and roll classic, here's Donny Osmond and the Jingle Bell Rock.
Oh, jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock. The jingle bells chime in jingle bell time. Dancing and prancing in Jingle Bell Square. In the frosty air.
Donny Osmond with the Jingle Bell Rock, the fourth biggest Christmas song of the rock era. Now, the song at number three is a story song that was written in 1958. Harry Simeon, Henry Honorati, and Catherine Davis took the tune from an old Spanish Christmas song, and they wrote new lyrics to it about a poor boy who has no gift to bring to the Nativity. All he can offer the Christ child is the playing of his drum. Well, the song was called The Little Drummer Boy, and it became a huge hit for the Harry Simeon Chorale. In fact, the album on which that song appears, an LP titled Sing We Now of Christmas, and later retitled The Little Drummer Boy, is the biggest selling Christmas album of all time. Here, from the Rankin and Bass animated production, is The Little Drummer Boy.
Heaven, do we all have need of your talents once again? You know the road to the manger. Lead us, son, with your drum.
My drum?
A mere few hours' work for a bell maker.
A drum! A drum!
Go, Aaron, and lead them, for I must be on my way back to Damascus. And always remember, God is with you.
Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill toward men. And each year the bells rang out to remind the people to come and rejoice with love and hope in their hearts and celebrate the Christmas Day.
Three in our exclusive Christmas countdown, The Little Drummer Boy. Up next, the Christmas song that Bing Crosby turned down, a song that went on to sell 100 million records.
You're watching an America's Top 10 Christmas with your host, Casey Kasem.
The song at number two in our special Christmas countdown has been recorded in more than 500 different versions, but the man who sang it first has the biggest version of them all. He's the most successful singing cowboy of all time. A man whose hits include such great standards as Yellow Rose of Texas, Tumblin' Tumbleweed, and Back in the Saddle Again, Gene Autry. We spoke to Gene and asked him to tell us how songwriter Johnny Marks came to give him this classic Christmas song.
Johnny Marks in New York sent me a demo of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. And I played it two or three times and laid it over to the side and said, well, I'll hear it again. And I heard several other Christmas songs. And along about July or August, that's when they record most of the holiday songs or Christmas songs, because they have to get their advertising out on them. Well, I had a session set up to do four songs here in the studio at Columbia Square. And my wife, Ina, said, you know, I think you ought to reconsider Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Said, there's something about that song that really gets to me. Said, everybody likes the underdog, and that line in there, they wouldn't let poor Rudolph join in any reindeer games, says it kind of makes me feel bad about him. And I thought, well, I'll take it down there. So I came down and I recorded three songs, had one to go in the session. So I told Carl Cottner, I said, Carl, bring out Rudolph and let's try it and see what it is. So the band run over it two or three times, and I did it a couple of times, and I said, all right, let's make it. So I recorded it, and after I finished, why, the engineer came out, and he said, Gene, you'll never make one better. Said, it's a good record. Said, I wouldn't make another take. I said, okay, if you like it, why, wrap it up. So they wrapped it up, and that was Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
After Gene's big success with Rudolph, he ran into Bing Crosby, and they had a talk about that million-dollar reindeer.
Well, I ran into Bing Crosby. I was in Studio B, and he was in A over here at Columbia Square. And I had a break for about 10 minutes, and it just happened he had a break, too, and I came out, and he was sitting outside smoking a pipe, and he said, say, he said, I understand that Rudolph has turned out to be quite a hit for you. I said, well, it looks like it is going to be a big hit. He said, well, shake hands with the guy that turned it down.
And as sung by Gene Autry, here's Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
You know Dasher and Dancer and Prancer and Vixen, Comet and Cupid and Donner and Blitzen. But do you recall the most famous reindeer of all? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose. And if you ever saw it, you would even say it glows. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. They never let poor Rudolph join in any reindeer games. Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say, Rudolph, with your nose so bright, won't you guide my sleigh tonight? Then how the reindeer loved him as they shouted out with glee. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, you'll go down in history. Then how the reindeer loved him as they shouted out with glee. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, you'll go down in history.
In all its versions, that song has sold more than 100 million records. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, performed here by a man who's become a legend, Gene Autry, the man who first introduced the song to the world. Well, now, before we get to the biggest Christmas song of the rock era, I'd like to tell you the true story of another Christmas long ago. You know, throughout history, the spirit of Christmas has inspired many men, but rarely as dramatically as it did more than 100 years ago. It was back in the year 1870, in the midst of the Franco-Prussian War, one of many wars between France and Germany. It was Christmas Eve, and the war was being fought on the outskirts of Paris. It was cold that night, And the men involved in that terrible battle were thinking of the loved ones they'd left at home. All about them were the sounds of battle, of cannons firing, of men dying. Then, all of a sudden, a young French soldier climbed out of his trench and stood there, an open target on the battlefield. He began to sing an old French carol, O Holy Night. A silence settled over the battlefield as soldiers on both sides listened. And then, when the French soldier finished singing, a German soldier climbed out of his trench and answered that French carol with a German Christmas song. And again, there was silence on the battlefield as the soldiers reflected on the message of peace that Christmas represents. Eventually, the battle would begin again and more men would die that night. But for a few moments, the spirit of Christmas, of peace on earth, and goodwill toward men, silenced the guns. Such is the power of Christmas, and of the music of Christmas. Now, we're up to the biggest Christmas song of the rock era. In fact, it's also the biggest selling song of all time, Christmas or otherwise. And sales of all versions are estimated at around 150 million copies worldwide. This incredible hit was written by Irving Berlin and was first heard in 1942 in the motion picture Holiday Inn. It won an Academy Award for Best Song that year. Supposedly, when Irving Berlin first played the song for the man who would sing it, Bing Crosby, Bing removed his pipe from his mouth and observed, "Irving, that's one song you don't have to worry about." With the biggest Christmas song of the rock era or any era, here's Bing Crosby with White Christmas.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know, where the treetops glisten and children listen to hear sleigh bells in the snow. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, with every Christmas card I write, may your days be merry and bright, and may all your Christmases be white. I'm dreaming of a white,
everyone out there a very, very Merry Christmas.
I would like to say Merry Christmas to all of my friends.
And before I leave, I want to wish everybody the best Christmas they've ever had.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas, Mother.
Merry Christmas, Mama. We love you.
I love you.
Merry Christmas.
Happy New Year, too.
And don't only be friendly at Christmas, be friendly all through the year.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Hi, everyone.
Christmases, Christmases be wild.
I'm Casey Kasem. That's our show. Thank you for joining us. On behalf of myself and the entire America's Top 10 family, let me wish you a very Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays. And remember, keep your feet in the ground and keep reaching for the stars.
And America's Top 10 Christmas was brought to you by Zales Jewelers, leading with style for Christmas.